honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
So, Buddhist friends, here we are in Wheaton, Illinois, in front of the headquarters of the Theosophical Society of Colonel Olcott and Madame Blavatsky. And here we're gonna conduct one meditation course and one speech on the conjunction of quantum physics and Buddhism. And you are welcome.
This is the main building in the Theosophical Society in Wheaton, Illinois. With John Scirosi, who is a facilitator here at the place, which is a syncretistic organization built up by Colonel Olcott and Madame Blavatsky in the early part of the century. And here you see the main hall at Christmas.
Good morning. Thank you for braving the snow, shoveling piles of snow off your car and coming out on this wintry day. It's actually very beautiful out there, and it could have been nicer tomorrow. But thank you for coming for the workshop today. Most of you know me. Who is here for the first time? Well, I'm glad that you've gotten to know us, and I hope that we will see you more often during the coming months. I'm John Chien Chiozzi. I'm the director of the public programs for the Theosophical Society here, and this is the national headquarters. So I organize the various programs that we do that includes lectures and workshops and retreats. In case you have not already taken one of our program catalogs, I do encourage you to take one. You'll find a list of many interesting programs, and some of them I'm sure will appeal to you. You can also find that information on our website, and there you can register for anything that appeals. But today I'm very, obviously very gratified to see such a fine turnout for this workshop. I thought it would be popular for a couple of reasons. One is because there is a lot of interest and need for meditation in our world today, but also because of the teacher. And the teacher always makes a big difference. It is somebody that inspires, of course, we feel inspired to rise up and come. So before I do introduce Bhante Samahita and say a little about him, I just want to mention a couple of the logistics, especially for those of you who are here for the first time. This is our auditorium where we have the workshops and lectures. Through that door, there are restrooms. There are also restrooms on the other levels, every level. And the level that you came in, the foyer there, there are restrooms there. There's one level below that, which is our dining area. There are more restrooms there, so you should have no problem with that. On every level and outside in this art gallery out there, you see there is a water fountain. If you like filtered water, there's hot and cold water available there. And that is also true on the other levels. We have put out some tea and hot water there for the use during the day when you have tea breaks. And my good friend Ben Furman here, he will make sure that the urn is topped up because it is rather small for the number of people. During the various breaks that you have, you're quite free to go down to the dining area. There's a coffee maker down there and tea that you can make use of as well. During the lunch break, the weather being as it is, you may want to have your lunch inside, and you can do that in the dining area. There are tables and chairs down there. For those of you who did not bring a lunch, of course, you can venture into the wilderness and gather from the various food stores that are available. Around the corner of Main Street and Geneva Road, there are a lot of places where you can get something to eat. And there's a Starbucks there if you need something strong. But That aside, there are many places in case you did not bring a lunch. If you did bring, of course, it's more convenient to eat here. So that's basically the housekeeping duties. You know, I am very, very honored to be able to introduce the Bhante Samahita to you. This is the first time I have met him on this trip, and it has been a great pleasure for me to be able to spend time with him, and an honor to be able to be in his presence and hear his teachings. And today he's doing this offering, you know, really trying to give you a very good handle on the practice of mindfulness of breathing, which is one of the classic Buddhist meditation techniques, very much praised by the Buddha. So you've got a wonderful day ahead of you. Those of you, probably everyone read the bio of Bhante Samahita. He's trained as a medical doctor, graduated from the Copenhagen University, and then an associate professor in various scientific fields of research. It's just an amazing bio. And the last part of it, of course, which is most pertinent to him offering this workshop, is that he, in 2003, was ordained as a Buddhist monk in Sri Lanka and has spent 16 years in a forest hermitage practicing meditation and studying the Buddhist teachings. So after 16 years of that sort of living, I'm sure he's got a lot of really good material to share with you. And so I hope you enjoy the day. I hope you find it rewarding. There is a schedule that Bhante has prepared there. It's one of those. There's flexibility there because of the time. Already we're over time. But he will be here for you, and you are here for him. And I hope it's a really rewarding experience for everyone. Thank you all. Bhante Samahita.
Good morning. Nice to see you here in the snow. I think we start with, as we usually do, a so-called vandana, a worship. If you can do like this, put fingers like this, and then up, and then just repeat after me. Namo. Tasso. Bhagavato. Arahato. Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy. Honorable. And perfectly self-enlightened. Vassa Blessed Buddha. Our teacher. He's the one who made this method. So we always do that before speaking Dhamma. We usually do it three times, but we'll be with one time. I'll just give a brief overview of what we're going to do today, because normally when you teach Anapanasati, it is done on a 7-day or 10-day course. So it's a very compressed thing we are trying to do. Nevertheless, we'll try to do it anyway, but we cannot, of course, go so much in detail as normally taught by 10 days. I recommend that you just, when I say something, if you come in doubt, then just make a mark at the time of the question appears to you, then we take the questions as they come along, because otherwise it would be kind of like too long a waiting time. I'll ask for questions also in the end of the exposition. The first one will be from 10:30 to 11:45. I first speak a little about the preliminaries, what you do before you do meditation, and then we'll have a guided meditation, an audio from around 11 o'clock to 11:45. It's 45 minutes audio where we can sit with closed eyes and then go through the whole sweep through the whole method, all 16 steps. And then after we have done that, we'll take a break, and then we take the first tetrad, explanation of bodily calm, and then we take a meditation on these 4 points, guided meditation on these four points. And then there's lunch. There'll be 1 hour for those of you who would like to go outside and who didn't bring food. 1 hour should be able to come. But otherwise, it is in the lower floor. You can take the elevator down. There's able to eat lunch. Then after lunch, we'll take the second tetrad. A tetrad means 4 points of contemplation. And this is basically about mental calm, and then we'll take a meditation there, and a 15-minute break, and then we will please be back here. I'll use this. It is not so loud. But anyway, this is start at an end. Then we will at 3 o'clock also take the third tetrad in 45 minutes, and then a break, and then the last tetrad in the afternoon until 5 o'clock. So it's a fairly compressed scheme, but I think we can do it. So on these tetrads, I first explain 4 points. What is meant by the words and what you usually do, and then we will do it in practice, in meditation. So there will be something like, for each meditation will be something like 20 minutes to half an hour. So everybody should be able to do it. I put under there, I put the meditation manual, which you can download from my website. It is basically this book, which you can buy for cheap dinner is I don't think it costs something like $2 or $3 if you like it in book form, but it's also free as in PDF form from this link. And this contains the Majjhima Nikaya, the source text, the Majjhima Nikaya number 118, the 118th speech of the middle length discourses of the Buddha, which sets forth this method. And it also contains the commentary, classical commentary to this sutta, and another commentary or treatise on it from the Pancita Sambhita Magga, The Path of Discrimination. And then it contains further material, some other speeches the Buddha have told about it. So actually, it's a method that he, or all Buddhas use for enlightenment. So it's a unique method. Actually, a whole book or chapter in the Samyutta Nikaya is based on this method. This book I can highly recommend, because there's more or less all the Buddha and his enlightened monks have said about this meditation method under one cover, basically. Whether you like it in PDF, I prefer to have it in book form, because then you can bring it to your pillow or have it on the night table. The second link I've given in this meditation schedule is a video I make on YouTube that you can go and watch also on this meditation method. And the third one is the audio we're going to hear here after the introduction. And if you like to receive a Buddhist newsletter from me, then you can send your email to, my email is written down here in the schedule, or otherwise there is a small block over there, yellow block, where you can put your email in capital letters if you like. So far, so good. It's a method I trained since my own beginning of being a Buddhist, something like 20 years. And it's always struck me when beginners come to my meditation hut up in the mountains, that whenever, even people who never heard about it before, they get something home. So it's, and I also learn something every time I try to do breathing meditation. So it's a method that keeps expanding, it keeps expanding. It's used by all the Buddhas for attaining enlightenment. And this is one thing. The second thing is that it by itself, only this method by itself can induce enlightenment, because it can induce or establish the four foundations of awareness or mindfulness and the seven links to enlightenment. And this means that basically it can take you from your state now and then all the way up to enlightenment, one single method. And this, I think, is rather impressive. There's also something called jhanas, the four jhanas, the four, we will come through the first one, the four absorptions. And this anapanasati can also induce all four jhanas. So it's not all meditation methods that can do that. There's 40 classic meditation methods given in the Buddhist text, but this one can induce all four of them. So this is another way it's unique. Look at that little from above. How can you attain jhana? How can you become enlightened? Yes, there's something called the five mental hindrances. What are the five mental hindrances? It's called nivaranas in Pali. They are sense desire, karma chanda, ill will, vyapada, lethargy and laziness, tinamitta, restlessness and regret, and doubt and uncertainty. And it said, as long as these, one of these are in the mind, or more of them is in the mind, then first of all, one cannot remember what one learns, and secondly, one cannot make any progress, and one cannot attain these jhanas, nor can one attain enlightenment. But interestingly, it takes only one breath, because these mental hindrances, these blocks, cannot coexist in the mind together with mindfulness or awareness of the breath. And this means that as soon as one establishes awareness of the breath inside the nostril, will come to it, then the hindrances are gone away. And this is really something one can practice everywhere, standing in the queue, while dishing, while sleeping, while talking together with others, while thinking your own thoughts, being on work. One can establish this mindfulness or awareness of the breath in one single breath. And thereby the mental hindrances are gone. Only for this particular moment, but nevertheless, it's kind of like an off switch for the mental hindrances. And this is, I think, therefore the Buddha placed so big emphasis on it. It is the only method that can switch off the mental hindrances in one single moment. And that is rather fantastic, I think. It's only, okay, it's momentary suppression. They come back as soon as you lose your focus on the breast touch, then they come back. But nevertheless, it's still a switch that one has if one is mindful or aware or deliberately redirect mind to it, then the hindrances will disappear as soon as one establishes mindfulness or awareness of the breath. Then I think there are other advantages, especially for Western people, because it stills directed and sustained thinking. That is to say, intellectualizing and wandering, and mind wandering is always a problem, speculation, worries, and so on. Everything that we under one hat call stress in the Western society, this is uniquely designed to still gradually, because it's impossible to have these speculations, this mind churning all the way while you're still focused on the breath touch in your nostrils. So it's particularly good for Westerners, particularly good. Another advantage is that it can induce, you can say in Buddhist meditation, there's kind of like two arms. One is calm, samatha, and the other one is insight. So calm is the pleasant state we will experience today, but calm is not a end goal in itself. So calm is the stepping stone or the tool or the means to attain insight. So it's the insight that liberates the mind. Insight into what? Yeah, insight into basically the three universal characteristics called tilakana by the Buddha, that everything, internal, external, mental, physical, past, present, and future, that this is impermanent, anicca, and it's, because it's impermanent, then it's also suffering, dukkha, dukkha, a bad state, and therefore it's also no self, not me, not mine, not what I am. And it's this insight that basically makes mind, which is typically want to grasp an object and thereby cling to it and thereby come to suffer for it because it is impermanent. This clinging is relinquished by seeing this repeatedly again and again. But it takes many times to see it because we, for an internal number of rebirths, including when we were ants and dogs and not only humans, but at all beings we have ever been to, then we have mistaken this to be me or mine or what I am. We have taken this to be me, mine, what I am, and a source of pleasure, a source of happiness. So we have thought of, if I just design this and that external form of samsara the right way, then I can get lasting happiness. Then it's a feasible plan in life. But this is not the case. And that's actually where one mistakes samsara. One mistakes it as a source of lasting happiness, while it's because of this universal impermanence always slips out between the fingers. And when it slips out between the fingers, if there's like or one takes delight in it, then one attaches to it, clings to it, and then one experiences suffering when it slips out between the fingers, when becoming old, when the object fades away, when one loses the object, when the money is lost from the bank account, when the fame or the reputation is going down, and so forth. All these things that we mistake for permanent objects, they are in the real essence impermanent. So to say short, this particular method, meditation method, is to calm down the mind in order to come to see that as it really is. One come to see that we will go through in what handles we use on it. Usually we will use something called the five clusters of clinging, or the five aggregates, to analyze what reality is, and then to see that all kinds of reality, whether mental or physical, fair or foul, that there are these three characteristics that are impermanent, they are suffering, and they are no self. And this is what releases, what relinquishes, because who wants what is suffering? If one really can see that it's suffering, then one let it go. And that's where it starts to get interesting. Over the years, one can say, if it's a practice one takes up under as a one's daily practice, then suddenly it becomes a vehicle. It becomes a little bit like a boat, or a car, or a train. One attains enlightenment gradually over the years. And first trick is to become fascinated or attached or captivated by the calm. And when one experiences this calm, to whatever level one experiences, then one will keep meditating. And if you keep meditating, then one will basically make it a practice and keep practicing. And then eventually it will be what we call well undertaken. And there, when it's well undertaken, it really pays off. Then the fruit comes gradually. It doesn't come like that. So it's something that, this goes for the whole Dhamma, the whole Buddhism. It only pays off, or it is very fair in the sense that it pays off what you invest. And that's why it's good to get a fair share of meditation hours on the pillow, especially in the morning. I can say how I practice myself, but it's good to practice at all days. Having practiced this for a number of years, it is best to do it in the morning, I find, actually. But it's difficult to do it when you have a working life. But doing it in the evening or after meals is typically difficult because you become too tired. It's not impossible, but it can be done. But I think it's better done before one goes to work. So this means already there it takes discipline. You have to get up at 5 o'clock, something like 5 o'clock, then do this hour. Then little tea or water in the face, and then sit down on the pillow. If one do it when comes home from work, then usually one is too tired. Then one can only do it in the weekend. So it takes some discipline, but it definitely worth investing. My own experience with it when I had a working life was that if you analyze the days that you have meditated when you come to work and versus the days where you didn't get the time to meditate, then there's a clear difference. Clear difference. You can go through the day very calm, focused, collected, in equanimity if you have meditated, while if you haven't meditated, then there will be this waves of disturbance, of agitation. Okay, so far so good. Little bit about posture. Now we sit here on chairs. I think this is in general best for, there's one gentleman on the floor. If you have bad knees or hips, then I think it's best to sit on a chair or to sit on anything that is solid but also soft with crossed legs. A balanced symmetrical position of the hands. It can be either like this, can be like this, can be like this. One thing of the code word is that you should be comfortable over a long time, because as soon as you experience pain, then it's more difficult to concentrate. And if you experience pain, severe pain, during every meditation, then usually you will say, I don't like to do this practice, because this is basically self-torture. So the pleasure of it, that's important. So that's why one should sit comfortable. I also like to say that the next Buddha, Buddha Maitreya, which comes something like 576 million years, he sits on a chair. He doesn't sit on the floor or cross-legged like the former Buddha did. So it's both postures are legal. If one is comfortable sitting on the floor, cross-legged, either in half or full lotus, then perfectly okay. But otherwise, I recommend sitting a little high, maybe not necessarily on a chair, but at least like this from the floor, so you get tension of the knees and tension of the hips. Then one should sit with a straight back. How is that achieved? If you take your thumb up here and hold, and then you can, just in the angle, the mandible come down there and then it goes forward, so just in the angle there, and then if you press up, look, like this, then suddenly you have the right posture. If the nose tip starts to go up, then it's too much. So it's, the nose tip should point straight forward. But you can notice with yourself, it's a good way of seeing whether, and this is something that takes years to get a good posture. The first thing that will happen when you start to relax is the nose tip starts going down. So, and then chin will also go down. So as soon as chin or nose tip goes down, you become aware of it, then reestablish the posture. Because if the breathing is natural and you have an open posture, the straight back, then the breathing is, the experience is much more pleasant. The next thing that's happened is that the back falls down like this, and then one comes to hang like this. And sometimes I will find myself sleeping, hanging in my back like this, with cross legs sitting up. And this is of course not meditation when you start to sleep, but just notice it starts with the chin, and the nose start falling a little bit. And as soon as if you can pick it up already there, then you're going to hold the posture. First the nose, and then the neck, and then the back, and then suddenly you slowly start to move. Can take 4, 5, or 10 minutes. Huh? But chin, to be aware of where the chin is, or the nose tip. If you have your breath touch on the nose tip, then it's usually easy to recognize. Symmetric position of the hands, either like this. This is a good thing because it also stabilizes a little bit. Otherwise, like this. Or like this. Sometimes you see people who sit like this. This is not a good idea because then you have to place too much awareness on your fingertips in this very awkward situation. It looks very, very Eastern, but it's not classic. No Buddhas sit like this, basically. This is basically Hindu praxis. So something that can be maintained for a long time without you noticing it. Basically, it should be like you park your car. So you park your body, and then the body should maintain its position without you paying any attention to it. So park a situation where the body feels like parked, like you park your car. This is the ideal thing. Okay. It's a good thing also to smile. because then you go into the meditation with a good spirit. Then what about the actual focus point? The actual focus point in Anapanasati is the sensation of breath in the nostrils. You can try to breathe forcefully through the nose, and then see where you actually feel it most. And let's just stay with it there. It is the tactile sensation, a little bit like cotton, when the breath goes in and out. So it's a very fine, very subtle focus point. But as soon as one can use earplugs also, I tend to use, because anyone can hear also the breath touch. I'm not going to hear the breath touch, but one can hear the breath, and then one will tend to focus on the breath touch in the nostrils. Somebody will have it on the upper lip, somebody will have it on the nose, but the common thing is the nostrils. When you feel it in the nostrils, one should not feel it as two distinct things, one nostril and another thing. One should feel it as one point. You can try now. What is this? Can we get this sound ready? Ah, tea kettle. Maybe we can switch it off. Yeah, that would be a good idea. The other good simile is, should one follow the breath down? No, it's not the case. One should, when you breathe in, the example is giving of a saw that is going back and forth. So a man sawing in a piece of wood, he will look only where the teeth touch the wood. So he would not follow, even though he knows where the saw is going back and forth, he still looks only where the teeth actually digs into the wood. And same thing also with this breath touch. If one starts to follow the breath down into the lungs and out again like this, then you start to pay attention to the saw, but not where it touch. So it should stay here and not nowhere else. So don't follow the breath down into the lungs or out into the air. Don't follow the inhalation or the exhalation out into the air. Then I would just speak, as basically one should not sit in pain. I'll say a little bit about brooming the mind. This is a preliminary practice that we always do. So before you sit down, before we start, one will kind of like say, can I broom out the five hindrances, the five mental hindrances? So one starts with a clean mind. And the first hindrance is sense desire, karma chanda. If then one will typically ask yourself, is there any sense desire in the mind? This would typically be, do I wish now to see something, hear something, taste something, touch something, think something? This is typically would be sense desire. So if, let's say, one is like to have a cup of coffee, then it will be sense desire after taste. If one wants to see something, it can be one wants to see a TV series, or one wants to open the eyes and see something, then it's also sense desire. Then we typically do this that we think of a corpse, or we think about our own skeleton. So we can do skeleton scanning, or we have usually a corpse picture. I have a picture of a small boy that has been drowned and has removed his cheek by animals that has eaten up. These pictures we call Buddha flowers. So one has a repulsive picture in mind of whatever one thinks is very, very disgusting. And this one redirects mind to. As soon as you redirect mind to something that you find very, very disgusting, usually a picture of a corpse in the Buddhist tradition, then you cannot have any sense desire. So it's kind of like an off switch. We call it the asubha nimitta, the disgusting aspect. So one redirects mind to a disgusting aspect, and boom, sense desire is gone. The next one is ill will. Is there any ill will in mind? This can be also resistance towards sitting on the chair, resistance towards meditating, speculations about other beings that one is not good friends with, one's employees or spouse or children or whoever it may be that one is aversive towards. Or it can be aversive towards situations that one doesn't like to be. For example, sitting on the pillow can also be this when one doesn't like to sit, basically. Then one will do the opposite. One will try to beam universal friendliness, redirect mind to universal infinite friendliness and goodwill towards other beings. Ideally, if it doesn't go away by beaming it out in front towards other beings in infinitude in space and number of beings, then one will beam it in six directions, to the front, right, back, left, below as above. And doing this, then this ill will go away. So this is kind of like brooming ill will out the mind. If there's lethargy and laziness, then there's two tricks one can do. Let's say one is tired, either or lazy. Laziness is in the body after meals, or tired in the mind after the job. Then one can either direct mind to the aspect of light, that is to say, look at a bright light, and then close your eyes, and then redirect mind to the same aspect of bright light. Then this will gradually evaporate. The other thing that one can do is typically, and this is a classic thing, is to redirect mind to one of three aspects: the aspect of initiative, the aspect of launching, and the aspect of endurance. When we typically say both on the pillow and in life, when we say to ourselves, now I cannot do this. Why can I not do this? Is it because of missing initiative? Or is it because of missing launching? Or missing endurance? Missing initiative could be typically the dishes has to be done and one is lying in the sofa, but one don't want to do it. So there's no initiative. It's a purely mental thing. one has not even thought of doing it yet. So one is opposed to doing the dishes. So that obviously this is what is missing. Then the situation can be, one actually wants to do the dishes. One wants to keep sitting on the pillow. One wants to reestablish focus on the breast touch in the nostrils, but one cannot kind of like do it. One cannot move out the legs. Then it's launching that is missing. Noting that it's launching that is missing, then it's easy to launch, basically. Either launch reestablishing mindfulness on the breast touch, or launch the legs out the sofa, or launch going out and do the dishes or whatever. So launching is where the initiative gets hold on the body and actually set the body going with whatever it should do to in order to get the task done. The last one, endurance, is can also be when you're sitting. This you have started to do the thing, but then after a little while one gives up the effort for various reasons. So one doesn't complete the task. So this is will be missing. Missing endurance, and this is typically where, when have it's easy to launch, it's easy to get initiative, but to have endurance to finish the task is where the hard points are learned. This has long been a focus in my own practice. If you sit down and do a meditation object, then one always finish it. That's a good thing to do. So, doing Anapana. One sits down, starts on the 16 point, okay, one also finishes the 16 points. One never raises from the pillow, unless the phone rings or something like that. Something that you have to do, then one can raise. But otherwise, one can, when one has memorized the 16 points, and that's why I've given you this this note, which you can bring to the pillow. As soon as you memorize it, I have memorized it for a long time ago, but you can just have it lying on your pillow. And if you like to render it, the translation or the rendering otherwise, then you can go into the root text and then do that. But this, I think, is a fair rendering of the meaning of the Anapanasati method. So how can you sweep through? Yeah, if you, for example, in the middle, phone rings or one likes to end for this or that reason, then one just repeat the 16 points to the end. Then one has finished the method. But one, of course, not have one have not dwelt properly in them. This was lethargy and laziness, tinamitta. Then is restlessness and regret. And there, typically, one will notice in order to get this restlessness, this unrest or agitation, which can be very slight. For example, just by drinking a cup of coffee, or drinking two cups of strong tea, then one you will notice that there's some wavering of mind, then one can typically notice, there's this calm of the body, and there's calm of the mind. And just by discriminating these two kinds of calm, then one will come down, the agitation will go down 50%. And this one can do again, and discriminate, there's calm of the body, and there's calm of the mind. This mnemonic device, one can use to get this tranquility set on. Then there's doubt and uncertainty as the last one, the last hindrance. There one typically will make four evaluations. One will say, this state I'm in now, or this aspect I'm considering now, there's doubt about, both on the pillow and while you're doing outside meditation. Is this aspect, is it advantageous or disadvantageous? Is it blamable or blameless? Advantageous or disadvantageous? Kusala and akusala, also sometimes translated as wholesome or unwholesome. This is basically the first discrimination or first evaluation. The next thing is, what will the teachers, what will my neighbors, what will the external world of other beings, what will they say to the regarding this aspect? And this will be whether it is blamable or blameless. The third one is, one will ask oneself, is this exalted or is it ordinary? State. And exalted could be any kind of calm you, as an example, you are experiencing on the pillow, while ordinary would be go out and open the fridge, for example, or taking a bath. But it's a discrimination that can be done with all situations, basically. There will be an exalted level and there will be an ordinary level. And the last thing is, which is a very fine discrimination, is on the bright side and also on the dark side. So these four discriminations, if one do this, then this doubt and uncertainty gradually over the time will go away, because just classifying it, whether it's advantageous or detrimental, one has to look into what this activity or aspect is actually is about. Then there's this is the first part of the preliminaries. Before we do, we will also, I think it's on the audio. Then there's the next thing, classical done before one starts breathing, before one starts on the first tetrad, and this is called counting. And so one count like this. There's two ways of counting. Typically, one will count up to 10, three times. And one will count up to 10 one way and then count up to 10 another way. So this means one counts to 10 six times in all. And the interesting thing is breathing in, we say breathe in, one. Breathe out, one. Breathe in, two. Breathe out, two. Breathe in, three. Breathe out, three. Breathe in, four. Up to 10. If one, let's say one comes, say 11 and 12 and so forth, then one has to start all over again. And this one can, I sometimes reach 31, counting completely unmindful of what I'm doing and missing the 10 point. But this is a very good preliminary practice to go back. Here, one will, when you say one, one, you will typically be aware on the upstroke and also on the downstroke of here, that is to say both the in-breath, the inhalation, the break between the inhalation and the exhalation, but not between down here in the valley, between the, in between the next one, because there one is typically not breathing. And therefore, as this we will also do today, therefore one takes another series that says one, two, two, three, because then three is in here, so three out, three in. Four out, four in. 5 out, 5 in, up to 10 again. And when this is finished 3 times, then one will usually stay to the practice. There already one is focused fairly good on what the breath touches and the length of one's breath. This is in, this was a counting, the other world of way of counting like this, 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 4, is connecting, then the next point is to make contact with the breath touch again when we start on the long run, so on the four tetrads. Then fixing this, so instead of one is contacting, one has contact on the breath touch, and there I can recommend when you close your eyes, then if you start to, if you look at your nose tip, for example, like now, now I'm making my myopic, my eyes kind of like look at my nose tip with both eyes. Then, because interest is going where the pupils are directed, then one will have a better tendency to make contact with the breast touch also. So if you just remember to do that when you close your eyes, then point the both eyes downward and to the medial side towards the nose tip. And then one cannot see the breast touch, but one will have a better access to it, because attention is already directed in this area. Observing, fixing is where the jhana occurs. Basically, one get the breast touch fixed, so it's not like attention is on and then off and then on and off. The object is going in and out outside attention, but it's staying there all the time. And that's where the absorption can occur, and which is very pleasant. If it occurs, and to the extent that it occurs, then one can observe it, that it has occurred. And there will be, the art of it will be to say, can I get it to remain? Usually if one tries, then one will slip, but keep coming back to it. Whenever mind goes into, strays into the forest of distraction, then one should haul it back by mindfulness. And it is described like you take an elephant, white elephant, the white mind, out the forest, and then you have to bang a pole deep down into the ground, and then tie this elephant with a mindfulness or awareness of this breast touch. Eventually, the mind, first of course, it wants to stray back into the forest. So it's a very wild thing and starts dragging in the pole. But eventually, after having circled this pole for a number of times, then it will lie down. So it will give up the fighting. And then this staying with the object, staying with the breast touch, become effortless. But this takes practice. This takes practice because mind is always a problem. Mind straying from one moment to the next moment, then it's inside. Your bills should be paid, and your family visits, and politics, and whatever, what have you. So this is the trick: is to see. One often will fall into the situation. Our distraction is going can be long time. Let's say 5-10 minute long distraction, thinking about something that is emotionally laden, your family situation or economical situation or whatever. As soon as you become aware of it, that the mind has strayed, then it's easy to hold it back. But the trick is to become aware of it. Of course, when you are aware of this distraction, your family situation or whatever it is, then there's no awareness of the breath. And then there are the full-blown 5 mental hindrances present in the mind. But as soon as one becomes aware of it, then it's easy to get the mind back on the track. But one has to become aware of it. And that's a trick, so to speak. See the distraction, right, and catch it right when it arrives, right when the mind strays from the breath touch in the nostrils. Then hold it back. It can be a distraction on 1 hour is not unusual. You will experience yourself. Whatever is going on in mind can be all kinds of stuff. Usually, something very emotional laden, or it can be all kinds of stuff from one's childhood. Then one suddenly sits there churning on the pillow, and then basically doing nothing, and just stacking up mental hindrances. So that is where one should say, "Ah, cut." By seeing it, and then back to the nostrils, to the breast touch, then immediately one will feel peace. So after having observed, then there's emergencies. One says, "What comes out of the state now is finished." This emergence is good to purify the state, to say what actually, when I emerge, when I'm launched out of this awareness of the breast touch, what made me go out? What made it end? How can I not make it end? So this will purify the states over time. And the last thing is, when one have emerged, whether it is whatever level of concentration one attains, we say there's always concentration in the mind to some extent. But classically it's described that there's, and this you will experience today, there's a short level of samadhi, of concentration. This we'll call kanika samadhi, momentary concentration. And then there can be various moments of it. The ideal, so let's say this is 1 second, and there is, the Buddha didn't say, but probably something like 100,000 billion, 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 billion mental states per second. Then there will be very few of them dispersed over this 1 second that one actually is aware of one's breast touch, or what one is doing, ideally. The ideal thing would be that every single mental moment that arises and sees, there this concentration and this awareness, this mindfulness of the breast touch is established and anchored on this object. So the whole practice is to, in this case it's a moving target, the breath going in and out, is to anchor the awareness on a moving target. So coming out, one reviews, and that is to say, you look around and say, how was it? Why so? Because coming out, then one has a chance to say, when reviewing it, one has a chance to say, what was the taste of it? What was the sign of it? And this is something that we say one should protect. The sign, what is the sign? Typically called nimitta in Pali. My sign, but it will be difficult, different for anybody else or for any practitioner. My sign is a breast touch, intensified sense of the breast touch in the nostrils. So it's a tactile thing. So it's not something, I don't see anything, but it can be anything. It can be a sensation of light. It can be a sensation of any object. It can be a mental sensation of peace that will keep coming back to one. after once a race touch is established, again and again. We say, or the elders say, protect the sign. So guard the sign or count the cost, and what is gained will not be lost. Who fails to have his guard well maintained will lose each time what he has gained. And that is because if you have the sign, then you can find back to it. It's like kind of like you've been out in the forest and then you found a very nice spot, the Samadhi spot, and then how did you come there, and how did it look, how did it taste, what was it? And then keep this sign close to in one's memory, because then it's easy to find back to again. So one should guard the sign. And this is the function of reviewing. It is to see how was it actually, and how did I come there, and how was I propelled out, pointed out of it. And it will, as I mentioned, it will be different from any one of you. But just remember how it is. How is it? How is it exactly? As I said, it can be visual, it can be tactile, it can be auditory, it can be so to speak, anything. But it's a symbolic representation of one's calm, something that is connected with one's calm. The next level of karmika samadhi after is what we call neighborhood concentration. One is in the neighborhood of the upachara samadhi, we call it. One is the neighborhood of jhana, of full absorption. But one is not there right yet. So it's like one is outside this building, but one has not entered the door. And then that's what we call Appana Samadhi, full absorption, where one has entered the door. And once suddenly one is in where the mind keeps repeating the same object, keeps staying with the object. Usually it is so, when first time one experiences it, either for seconds or for minutes, then one becomes attached to it, because it's excessively pleasant. This means that when you like to come back to it next time, then you start having sense desire after a mental state. This is to say, like you like to open the door. You are coming up to the door, and then you reach out of the handle. And what I'm saying is, don't. Don't reach out of the handle. It's okay to find the door, but the door has to go up by itself. If one starts to urge to have the state, to find the state, then one will not attain it. And this is typically because then the first mental hindrance of sense desire, kamachanda, has set in. One wants to have a mental state, just like orgasm or intoxication by smoking joints or whatever. It is the same thing, basically. And then it cannot happen. So one's own urge, delight for it, will actually exclude that one attains the state. So one thing or one trick is to say, okay, I circle the house, and if it happens, then it happens. I will let it happen, so to speak. And then one can approach the door, one can approach the state without urge, without craving, and then one would experience, if done correctly, the door will go up by itself when one approaches the state. And then one can enter, then one have access. But as soon as you start craving, then one will find the door locked. And this can be a real hindrance, and it is usually caused by that one sees, now I'm making progress. And then suddenly craving, very strong craving for making further progress starts. And because it's very pleasant, very pleasant, much more pleasant than orgasm, and much more pleasant than any other sense pleasure can come about, I would say. Also regarding drugged experiences. Because why? Because it's pleasant at the and calm, and experienced as peace, at the same time it's very clear. So it's not muddled, nor is there any agitation that like there is, for example, in orgasm, which is also pleasant, but which also is felt like a kind of like electric shock and cannot be maintained for a long time. So it's a very subtle, intense, exquisite form of pleasure and happiness that cannot be compared to any other thing that one has experienced. And therefore it is strongly addictive at the first time one experiences. But be careful at that point. Let it be, let the state be, let you approach the state, then you will see it will happen if one doesn't want it to happen. A gentleman just asked me how to become enlightened, which is of course a very relevant question. not so easy to answer in short words, but we discussed that the last Buddha, it took him 6 years, but the shortest period is 7 days. And the next Buddha, Buddha Ariyamatteya, the noble friend, he will do it in 7 days. What is the basic, what you said, very short, there's a very terse saying in Pali, which goes like this: Sila, Samadhi, Panya. So the Noble Eightfold Way, which is the way that leads to the end of suffering, goes through these three stages. What does Sila mean? Sila means morality or ethical purity. And it basically, for lay people and for all beings, goes by accepting the five training rules, which defines a Buddhist. So is to say, the first, I accept training rule of avoiding all killing. Two, I accept the training rule of avoiding all stealing, or of taking what is not given, adinadana. I accept the training rule of avoiding all sexual abuse, is number three. I accept the training rule of avoiding all false speech, number four, and I accept the training rule of avoiding all use of intoxicant in use, including alcohol and drugs that cause carelessness. These five precepts are what one promises to keep. It's not a promise in the sense that kind of like one puts a promise because they're difficult to keep. Modern psychology says that we lie 5 times a day if they put video cameras on us. So it can be difficult for each one of them, but one accepts it as a training rule. This, together with one take refuge in the Buddha, Dhamma and Sangha, then defines a Buddhist, basically. So if one has taken refuge, that is to say, I want to obtain protection from this Buddha, this is the last Buddha, in this case Gotama, but also all the other prior Buddhas that have been in through time, and the next Buddha that has come. The Dhamma, which is a teaching of the Buddhas, and the Sangha, which is basically the disciples of the Buddha. If one takes refuge in these three institutions and accepts these five training rules, then one is, per definition, a Buddhist. And then this path starts with this sila, this moral purity, the five precepts as minimum, which then lead to samadhi, which then leads to concentration. Why is that so? Because concentration, the proximate cause of concentration, is happiness, is joy, is gladness. So if one finds happiness in a given moment, then one can also find absorption. Otherwise, mind will keep looking, scanning for this happiness, where to find it, which is the purpose of happiness, of consciousness, is to find happiness, and the purpose of life also. So if he hadn't found it, then it cannot keep, stop scanning, and thereby it will keep looking after it, and thereby it cannot find concentration. So how to attain happiness, how does moral purity lead to happiness? Because of absence of regret and remorse. And this means as soon as one has transgressed a moral rule, for example lied or committed insurance fraud or done anything, killed, whether animal or human, or harmed other beings in the minutest sense, then one will later on regret, experience regret and remorse. And this will exclude happiness. Especially when you sit down on the pillow, then some transgressions that has occurred 20 years ago, they will come back to mind and knock the door and say, ah, but you said this was the right thing to do, but then you did this and that because of temptation, because of fear, because of desire. Then you did one thing, something that was bad, and then one experienced this regret. This can be a large part of the word of a work of attaining concentration, is to root out these transgressions and seeing them as transgressions. In the beginning, one will say, I didn't do it, one will deny. So mind will go into denial, or it will completely hide it up so one cannot see it again, one's own transgression. Or it will diminish it and say, ah, maybe I did do it, but only very little. Or you can also, another thing is to say, circumstances did it. It was because of my colleagues, or because of politicians or my mother and father or my upbringing and so on. So I more or less had to do it. Another bad excuse. So all kinds of stuff then one wants to reject when one actually did it. While what is one, the resolving of the situation is that one actually sees it as it is, that one did it and it was because of either greed, hate or ignorance or fear, for this or that reason, one did this and that. And then admit it to oneself. Ideally one will go out and get resolve it by giving the stolen thing back or making an excuse or correcting a lie or falsehood or whatever it is. This is the ideal case. But if this cannot be happened, then the Buddha say one should strike it again and again as a hand strikes the bell. And then gradually one's regret and remorse will go down. But first the moment one really sees the wrong is wrong, then one can do it. If one denies it or diminishes it or reduces it or evades it, then one will keep staying in regret and remorse. And this will then exclude happiness, which will then exclude absorption, concentration, which then will exclude the last thing, panya, wisdom. So sila, moral purity, leads to samadhi, concentration, which then leads to panya, wisdom. Wisdom will, in the ultimate sense, be to see the Four Noble Truths, which are the following. This dukkha, this, all this is suffering. What about pleasure? Is that also suffering? Yes, because it's impermanent. It's not permanent. So pleasure or happiness is a gladness. It's very agreeable when it arrives and when it is there. It's on the top point, but when it starts to go down, then it's disagreeable. So pleasant feeling is also a form of suffering. What's the cause of suffering? How does it arise? Dukkha samudaya. It arises because of craving. Craving, there are three kinds of craving. Craving for sensuality, seeing something, hearing something, tasting something, touching something, smelling something, and experiencing mental states, such as orgasm or drug mental states. It's craving for becoming, typically becoming young, rich, beautiful, praised, healthy, famous. Craving for not becoming, vibhava tanha. Craving for not becoming old, disrespected, foolish, ugly, and so forth. So this craving that mind is always pushing for being somewhere else and being something else than right where it is right now, this is what creates the suffering. What is then the end of craving, or the end of suffering is the end of craving. So dukkha nirodha means basically that this craving for certain things, first of all sensuality, and sensing various things, and then craving for becoming various states, liked states, and not becoming all disliked states. When this ceases, then also ceasing. That's a ceasing of suffering. And this basically leads to the Fourth Noble Truth, which is the way, the Noble Eightfold Way, to the absence of craving. Seeing this, these Four Noble Truths in one go is wisdom. And this is the purpose of the training, is to see this. This we are doing today is only a tool in one of many tools in the toolbox to come to see the Four Noble Truths. But this one cannot come to see before one has calmed down or stilled the mind. If one backs a little bit further out, then there's something what we are training today is to attain the four foundations of awareness, which are the following. Is seeing the body only as a frame. If one should say it very shortly, not as me, not as mine, not as what I am, not as pleasure, not as something lasting, not as something I can keep, basically as something I have on loan, I have to put it down in the grave at the end. So one ceases also as suffering. Seeing the feeling only as a reactive response. So whether it's pleasant feeling, painful feeling or neutral feeling, that is something that is passing. Feeling arises from contact. As soon as contact is not there, then feeling also ceases. This means that one does not become repulsed by painful feeling or unpleasant feeling. One does not become attracted to or enamored by pleasant feeling, nor will one become bored by neutral feeling. So feeling has this important, the Buddha said everything converges to feeling. What does he mean by that? He You mean if one is unaware? We are trying to train awareness of mindfulness now. In a case of feeling, then one should see the feeling arise, pleasant feeling arise, or painful feeling arise, or neutral feeling arise, staying present and going away again. If one does that, then one escapes the following mechanism. If unaware, not aware, then when pleasant feeling arise, then one will tend to have greed for the object or have lost attraction to the object, and there, right there, greed arise. So whenever one is unaware of pleasant feeling, one is stacking up greed, which is one of the root defilements. Huh? If aware of pleasant feeling, then one can see a pleasant feeling arise, pleasant feeling is there, pleasant feeling go again. Then one will not stack up greed for the object, for the same object, or for similar objects. Same thing with unpleasant feeling, painful feeling. Painful feeling is disagreeable when it arises and when it's there on its maximum, but when it goes away, then it's felt as relief. Imagine that you have stopped, you have pain in your knee, or you have a painful feeling in the mind, for example, frustration or sadness. Then when it goes away, then it's felt as relief, then it's felt as agreeable. So if painful feeling arises when one is unaware of it, then it feeds repulsion, it feeds aversion, one wants to push it away. So hate and aversion and repulsion arise right there and grow. So every unpleasant feeling, not seen as it, not being aware of it, stacks up hate. So these are the two root defilements, greed and hate. What about ignorance? It is connected to the neutral feeling. If unaware of neutral feeling when it arises, then it's subjectively felt as boredom, then because mind is scanning for pleasure all the time, then you look away and wants to see another object, have another pleasurable object. Then because of not looking at the object one has contacted and arisen, has given a rise to neutral feeling, then one becomes ignorant about this object. And then ignorance arises right there. While if one is aware of neutral feeling arise, neither pleasant nor painful feeling arise, then it's felt as peace and exquisitely pleasant or agreeable, we can say. And then ignorance does not arise. Rather the opposite. What we're trying to do here is to establish a peaceful mind. When this peaceful mind is established, then we become very curious how to establish it again because it's felt as agreeable. So these three mechanisms of feelings has to be known. If unaware of feeling, then one stacks up greed, hate and ignorance, basically stacking up future suffering. If aware of feeling, pleasant, painful or neutral, arise, being present and ceasing, then one does not stack up greed, hate and ignorance. So this was feeling, this was the second foundations of awareness. Seeing the mind only as moods is the third. We'll come to that a little later, and then seeing all phenomena as mental states is the fourth foundations of awareness. This basically develops the following seven links to enlightenment, namely awareness itself, sati, of what's going on internally, externally, both in oneself and in others. Investigation, so when it starts to investigate states, it's closely related to what we in the West call curiosity. One starts to examine, one doesn't skip or step on further, one starts to look at the phenomena going on. Energy or vidya, also closely related to what we in West call the enthusiasm. So one starts to examine with great enthusiasm and what puts in forth effort. So this also is a link to awakening. When one does that, then joy arises, piti, a form of rapture, which is very pleasant. One feels, now I'm doing progress. When one experiences this joy, a certain satisfaction arises, and then tranquility follows, prasadi. This is also a link to awakening. When tranquility is there, concentration arises. This is what we are trying to do here today. And finally, when concentration is there, then one can look on the object as if from above, and then one will look at it with equanimity, with serenity. And then one will come to see it as it really is, jnana, bhuta, dasana. So seeing this as it really is, one is not connected with any emotion, like or dislike, whether it's one's own body or other's body or the whole world or the whole samsara one would just look at it and see, ah, it is really true. This is impermanent. This is suffering. This is no self. This is empty. And thereby one is relinquished from this particular object, whether it's one's own body or the whole world. And this is what it releases, basically. So these seven links, Bhuyangas, to enlightenment is what we will train today, or what is built up by this training, little by little. Okay, let's go back to the, if you take your this note, you can just see the first tetrad. Breathing in long, he knows, notes, and understand, I inhale long. Breathing out long, he knows, notes, and understand, I exhale long. Basically, inhale. Why do we start with inhaling and exhaling long? This is because this calms down the mind. So one starts to calm. And this you can do in your follow in your own practice. Any long, fine, not so it's felt as you get urge, but as long as fine as you can make it without getting urge, this will calm down the mind. You can try now and then focus on the breath touch and then breathe long and fine. Then immediately mind is felt as subjectively going into calm. So if one notice while doing this practice of Anapanasati that there's some agitation, even the slightest agitation present, then one can try to set the speed and the depth, make the speed slower and make the depth a little longer, and also make the breath a little more fine. And then one will tranquilize the mind even further. So the idea is, breathing in long, one notes or knows and understands, I inhale long. Let's say you start with an inhalation and then you breathe in, and then after the inhalation you lose awareness. Then you cannot, when you come to the end of an inhalation, then you cannot say whether it was long or short. So if one should be able to characterize when the end of inhalation has ended, whether it's long or short, then one has to be aware of it, stay with it all the time. One can also have a middle class, say, ah, this is a middle long inhalation. But as soon as you, this is usually what happens, you start inhaling, you become unaware, and then you stop inhaling, and then you're not able to say whether it was long or short. So this one, you start notice, ah, I cannot characterize this inhalation as long or short. So apparently I've been unaware. While if one has been aware, then one can say whether it was long or short, or middle length. So this you can try right now, take some in-breath and out-breath. And see whether you can stay with the in-breath and out-breath so you are able to characterize it as long or short. I'll typically, breathing in long, I'll typically at the end of the inhalation say long. And out of the exhalation, if it's long, I'll say long also. Or short, or medium. The second point is breathing in short. One knows, notes, and understand, I inhale short. Breathing out short, one knows, notes, and understand, I exhale short. Same thing, one can notice, if you do like this, very brute, very short, then immediately mind becomes alert. So instead of dozing off, mind becomes very alert. And this one can use as a speeder. The long breath is like the brake, but the short breath is like the speeder. So if one tends to say, ah, now I'm going into laziness, now I'm drifting into something that is too calm, too slow, then one can set the speed of just a tiny itch, tiny notch up, so the breath becomes a little shorter. Then one will experience, ah, okay, now one's alertness is raised just one bar, and then one can stay with the object again. So one doesn't kind of like slide off, but one has to be aware of it. Again, if you take short in and out breath, not forced, but just short, then you should be able to say after the in-breath, short, and after the exhalation, short. I'll typically, when I go through this, I will take 3 long inhalation and 3 long exhalations, minimum, and 3 short inhalation and 3 short exhalations when I go through these 2 first points. But one can also do a little more than that. Again, at the end of the sweep, these 2 points, evaluate what the mind is. Is it too slow? Is it too calm? Or is it too alert? Is it agitated? Number 3, he trains us, experiencing entire body, I'll breathe in and out. What does it mean by the entire body? Yeah, I typically do 4 exercises, which is mentioned in the commentary. The one is to see the entire body from outside. You can see it from any angle. One can also start circling around the body, seeing your own body sitting down. Visualize your own body sitting down where you sit now, but as if you sit alone. In one go, so not like only seeing the face or the feet, but seeing from head to toe while you're sitting on the pillow. And can see from one angle or from several angles. So then one sees the entire body. Then one can either see the surface of it, or one can train, visualize that one also has the internal organs in one go, all the visual organs under the clothes, like X-ray vision in one go. Then typically number 2 will be to do body scanning, which we will also do when we make this exercise. I will typically start with the skull of the head. We can do only the bones, if one knows the bones well. I can recommend looking at a skeleton or in an anatomy book. One can do various level of organs, and then one scans down to the little toenail, go over to the other little toenail, and then scans up again. An easy way of sometimes attaining absorption is to not to go too quickly, not to go too slowly. And suddenly you will experience that instead of you see only a teeth, or then you see also the holes in the teeth and see it under a microscopic, in a microscopic perspective. Or your skull of your knee, or a hair on the leg. And if one doesn't go too quickly over it during this visualization, then suddenly one can gain absorption right there. This is called Kayagata Sati, mindfulness or awareness directed to or going with the body. So this scanning one typically go up and down. The next thing is to consider the body as elements. So one sees it as the 4 great elements in Buddhism is the earth element, solidity, which is basically extension, the covalent bond in chemistry. One sees it as the water element, fluidity, which is basically the hydrogen bond in chemistry. One sees it as heat, which is basically vibration, thermal vibration. And one sees it as movement, which is basically kinetic energy, or movement of, can say, the breath or movement of the blood. So these things one can consider both inside and outside. When, for example, if we take solidity, solidity is a prevalent element, or yes, element in the teeth, in the bones, but also in the cement and in the floor and in the metal. And if you do that over a prolonged practice, then suddenly one will start to identify the solidity. So one sees, this solidity that I thought was individual, was me, mine, what I am, this is basically the same solidity that is in the cement wall. So this one, this identification one has with one's own solidity, this is cut. And this is basically a sign that the clinging to the body is cut. And thereby the fear of losing the body is cut. So one becomes indifferent towards losing one's own body. Because one sees it's basically the same element. It's not one's own, it's just solidity. Here and in the cement block, it's just heat and motion. Here and outside, and so forth. So one tries to consider the 4 great elements, define the 4 great elements, as I said, both internally and externally. Past, present and future, one sees it, it's always like that. The last one is, the Buddha mentioned that there's another body, he's called the breath body. So he would say typically that there's more than one body. There's the physical body, this is basically this one. Then he would say there's a mind-made body, a body of consciousness, that is superimposed the physical body. And then he would say also that there's this breath body, which is a body in and of itself. And how to come to experience it? This is a little subtle. One typically experiences it when noting after a prolonged period the beginning, the middle, and the end of the inspiration, and the beginning, the middle, and the end of the expiration. And then, if successful, then one can identify, oh, now I'm blowing my breath out, and right there stops the exhalation, and then suddenly one can experience something still going out. And there's more movement of air, one is sure about that, but something is still going out. And this is the breath body. It's very subtle. It's difficult to explain, otherwise to saying that it's this kind of movement. One feels that something is moving, and it's not the breath. And this is the breath body. Awareness is, of course, becoming sharper and sharper and sharper by this being able to see where one's inhalation start, the middle of it, and the end. And it's typically said that either you can identify the middle, the start and the middle, or you can identify the middle and the end, but there is few who can identify both the start, the middle, and the end. You can try now and see whether you can try to breathe a little and then see how God's the handle you have, or the exact start point and the exact end point. Experiencing the entire body, these four exercises. Again, one visualizes from outside or from inside, one scans, one sees it as the four great elements, and one tries to identify the breath body by this beginning, middle, and end. The last one, calming all bodily activity, I'll breathe in and out. And then I typically calms four qualities, which is like a gong. You strike a gong, then you can listen to the gong, that the sound goes off, just like when we strike this one, then one can listen, it's still there, but reducing. A similar thing one can do with bodily activity. So with this one we'll gain a more and more subtle experience of movement of the body. So gross movement will be like you're moving around on the chair. A little less gross movement will be that you're breathing in and out. So this can become very fine. When you breathe out, then the breath suddenly stands still. But where does it actually stand still? So first one tranquilizes the gross movement, then the inhalation and the exhalation. Then I typically also tranquilize my pulse. This one can just feel. Or if one can hear it, I use earplugs and I can hear my pulse. And the third thing is when I experience or I visualize that I'm calming the metabolism of the body. So if breath goes down and pulse goes down, then blood flow also goes down. Then the burning of sugar in all the tissues also go down. So then one calms and tranquilizes everything from gross movement, which is one form of bodily activity, onto the chemistry of the body, which is the most subtle form of tranquilization one can do. And this is more or less the first citrate. Now we'll come to the second citrate, but I'll maybe expand a little bit about why we do this by brewing the mind. It is so that in the ideal case, one can reach all four jhanas, but just to reach the first one, on the first absorption, there has to be five things present and five things absent. So what are the five things that has to be absent? Sense desire has to be absent. And these are things are naturally ensured the moment one is locked on the breath touch. So sense desire has to be absent. Sense desire in part is karma chanda. ill will has to be absent, vyapada in Pali. Lethargy and laziness has to be absent, chinamitta, restlessness and regret, udaccha kukuccha has to be absent, and doubt and uncertainty has to be absent. But all these five are absent as long as one keeps the breath touch. As soon as you lose the breath touch, then one or more of them, these five hindrances, nivaranas, they can be present again. And then one cannot gain absorption. Then what are the things that should be present then? This is directed thought, vichaka vichara, sustained thinking, enraptured joy, piti in Pali, a pleasurable happiness, sukha, and unified single-pointed focus, in Pali called ekka gata citta. Citta, mind, ekka, one, gata, going. Mind going one place, only one place. Unified focus. One-pointedness of mind is also a good translation. So the five hindrances has to be absent. How does one do that without even thinking about it? Locking on the breast touch. As soon as one is locked there, they are by guarantee absent. Then the five jhana factors has to be present. What is directed thought? Directed thought is that, for example, you're doing, while you're thinking on the knee, it's like setting a toy train on the tracks. And then this is directing, deliberate directing of the thought. Can be any object, any thing. Sustained thinking will then be that it stays in the thinking line. For example, if you're going from the knee to the tibia, to the heel bone, to the toe, then that it follows this natural thought, this natural line of thinking. It doesn't go into other lines of thinking. So directed and sustained thought. Directed thought and sustained thinking. Thrill, joy, piti is what you experience if you say, yippee! It's kind of like this very, there's some agitation, but also a very kind of like explosive joy. Explosive joy. Enraptured joy, basically. And yet usually I actually say, in order to get it, I usually say for myself, yippee. And this is also what we do during this practice. It is so, what is the cause of joy? The Buddha says joy itself. So if joy feeds joy itself, you can try to, if you think about joy, you start smiling. So joy is its own cause, basically, if mind is redirected to it. Then pleasurable happiness. Sukha can mean both pleasure, which is something bodily, and happiness, which is something mental. So I think this is the best translation, a pleasurable happiness. One feels pleasure in the body, and that's why the posture is so important. If you start doing a yoga thing or something like that, have pain in the knee, then forget it, because you'll never get absorption sitting, having some kind of agony here or there or whatever, physical pain. There has to be comfort, one feel comfort, comfortable with the body. After calming it here, it's easy. There was obviously comfort in your body when we stopped the former session, huh? Right when we stopped, and I asked you to identify the calm, then there was calm, comfort in your body. Huh? Then it's ready, then it can occur. Then same thing with the mind. There should be some level of gladness or satisfaction or calm or at the minimum acceptance of whatever state the mind has. But I would say a little more than that. Some it's like a level of satisfaction with whatever state the mind has. Then the door is basically open. Because in some degree of pleasurable happiness is present. Then the presence of this unified single-pointed focus, ekagata citta. Yeah, this will be that one is locked on whatever one is locked on. Doing scanning, it is easy to lock on a, for me at least, as a doctor, on an anatomical detail, usually blown up in to microscopic scale. So I will see the trabeculae in the, inside the bone marrow, or I will see a feeling in my teeth, or can be any anatomical detail, a hair root, or the surface of the skin, or some muscle fibers, or something like that. And then it suddenly get one suddenly can get access. But it can be anything. I think also it's difficult, different for different people. Can also be a thought. can be basically anything, just that mind stays only with this object. It doesn't jump anywhere. So it stays only with this object, then suddenly one can have an opening, so to speak. How is it felt subjectively? If I should say, for example, if it's a teeth and you see a feeling in your teeth, then instead of looking at the teeth from only one angle outside, then it's subjectively felt not exactly as you're inside the teeth, but as one can effortlessly see and experience the teeth from several angles at the same time. So one loses perspective in the experience. What I think actually is one is sampling information directly. One doesn't, it's not a visual thing. If it's, let's say it's an aspect of suffering, dukkha, one sees dukkha doing absorption, then one suddenly is stunned by the totality of this situation of all beings, that they are running around in an impermanent world looking for a permanent happiness, which is, of course, utterly impossible. And then suddenly one is stunned by this, that it cannot be otherwise, and they keep running. And one is also oneself a part of this homunculus running around in a big house, in the big mirror house, so to speak, where one runs into karmic echoes from one's own past, and it seemingly cannot get out of this samsara. So one is stunned. Not now I speak it, I try to explain it in concepts and words. It's not like that. One is stunned by the whole gamut in one single experience. And it's overwhelming. It's overwhelming in this case. But it can also, in the case of absorption into an anatomical detail, then it's, because it's connected with this pleasure and this enraptured joy, then it's basically a very pleasant experience. It's not painful by any means. But it's overwhelming. Characterized by, there's nothing else, one cannot see anything else. So it's not normally like you are thinking a thought, but then almost immediately you're distracted. And then you have to, if one, for example, do analytical thinking, saying, what's the cause of A, this is B, then what's the cause of B, this is C, and so on. Then one cannot do this rationally because one is cut off by a distraction. Then say you try to identify C, the causal factor of C as D. Then suddenly you have a distraction, then you have to go all the way back to A, because you cannot remember to where you were. And this is extremely inefficient. In absorption it's not so. It is so if you put the train on the train of thought on the line, then it effortlessly and almost automatically, I would say almost effortlessly, go to the end of the thought, end of the line. So you see it more or less, not instantly, but you're not disturbed by these distractions that one is normally disturbed at. Say, where was I? How was it? Something like that. So it's very pleasant, very efficient. Most vipassana insight work is done in first jhana. What is, if one should say in one factor, then it's basically happiness. Basically happiness. And that's why purification of morality, sila, is so important. Why so? Because if there's no sila, and has been no sila for a long time, then there's a whole stack, a whole mountain of regret and remorse that has to be purified first. And so this can take years, basically. If I should expect as 10 factors, then it's full self-control by purifying morality. Something that helps outside is guarding the sense doors. That one doesn't let the eye run after the pleasant object, or the tongue, or the ear, or the pleasant touch. One guards the sense doors. So one is not overwhelmed by, as we just were during lunch, by pleasant feeling, pleasant sensations, or by repulsive sensations, or by neutral sensations. So one guards the sense doors as a normal praxis. Basically, because if you're guarding the sense door outside of the pillow, then when you sit down on the pillow, then this first hindrance of sense desire, you have a better chance at dealing with it. Because you are just like a snake that has seen a rat coming down into this ant nest where there's a lot of holes, this anthill, like looking, could also be a cat, like looking, ah, what hole will the rat come out of? So one should guard the sense doors. What sense will I now see? Am I looking for something? Am I smelling for something? Am I looking for some pleasant taste or some pleasant touch? What is it? Where will this sense desire next leap? Huh? So in the unaware case, the mind will always try to find sense pleasure because there's a small blip of happiness. So it's scanning continuously. Where can I find my next sense pleasure? Where's my next sex object? Where's my next food object? Where's my next entertainment? And the phone, and the news, though not very entertaining or happy. So it's continuously scanning. And this is because it has a tons of times experience, I get a small piece of happiness. As soon as you get a small piece of happiness, then it stops scanning. But as soon as you start scanning, then unfortunately excludes this jhana that is experienced as happiness. Moderate in eating, that is, tends to eat a little bit less. If one eats less and one tends to eat normally, then one have a better chance. Wakefulness at night, this is typically, some of the Buddhist monks, Anuruddha, was known to not have slept for 25 years. And he never lie down either. So awakening is, yes, one thing is the awakening of their mind, but it also is an expression of they keep awake basically for a long part of their life, So prior preliminary work with the meditation object, what we are doing now here, master in directing mind to the sign of absorption. That is, if you have experienced entry one time, then one comes back to this, how this entry was. Master in attaining first calm, then unified focus. Master in determining the duration in advance, as soon as you are clicking in, how long time should it last. Master in at emerging from this exalted state, and then master in reviewing. As soon as you can review and say, how was it, then you can find back to it, because then you can protect the sign. If you cannot remember the sign when you sit down on the pillow of your best state, last time you meditated, then it is like the Buddha Gosa said, and every time you start, you have lost. Whatever you have gained, you lose again. So you can kind of like back to square one. So remember the sign, keep the sign close to your heart of your best performance. Then some additional supporting qualities from the Visuddhimagga, clean body and clean dwelling place. If you've just been in a bath, it's easier to meditate well. And if there's no mess in the building and around you. Skill in remembering and extended design. Skill in restraining the distracted mind. Skill in calming the agitated mind. Skill in encouraging the bored mind that want to do something else and meditating. Skill in observing the well-working mind. Avoiding scatterbrained persons. That is all those who don't, non-meditators, for example, or journalists, or whoever. Your colleagues, your children, your spouse maybe. Frequenting well-focused friends. And then reviewing the liberation of the jhanas. And lastly, resolute determination to succeed. These are all factors that are kind of like working in the same direction of gaining jhana, gaining access. So much about this, I think. Then I'll give a little bit about the second tetrad. Experiencing enraptured joy, I'll breathe in and out. As I said, you can, how to experience joy, this question I often get. I say to myself, you be, and then just this short, you be, which is so kind of like comic and crazy, I get small joy. And this small joy, if I can just keep clutching onto that, it'll become a bigger joy. And if you just keep clutching on that, it'll become even a bigger joy. And then you turn it on, and that's enough. That's enough. Another thing, if you're a very devout Buddhist, is to remember the three jewels. The Buddha, the Dhamma, and the Sangha. If one is a very devout Buddhist, one often is filled with awe. This is I at least. So the Buddha is not only the last Buddha, but also the endless row of other Buddhas. We know the 24 Buddhas before Buddha Gautama, there's been four Buddhas in this universe. Kampa number 5. It's the only universe we know of in the entire Buddhist history where there's 5 Buddhas. We call it a Bhatta aeon, a very fortunate aeon. So there was one called Kakusanta, Kunagamala, Kassapa, and then Gautama was the last one. And the next one will be called Mitteya, the friendly one. Ajita Mitteya, the unconquerable friend. The unconquerable friend. They call him Bhujaraja, the king of the Buddhas. Much of his life is known, actually. Thinking about that, the Dhamma is what they put forth among this meditation method. But basically, the Noble Eightfold Way and the Four Noble Truths and the 37 states or producers of enlightenment. Basically, they put forth a way to deathlessness. And it's the only way to become deathless. They put a way to lasting happiness, to absolute freedom, to complete peace, to what we call Nibbana, which means gone out of samsara. It's like a going out of a flame. You cannot say or ask meaningfully, where has the flame gone? It has not gone anywhere, it's just gone out. What was the flame burning on? It was burning on greed, hate and ignorance. So nothing is lost. And one should not be afraid of Nibbana when we come to insight later on. One should give up the body, renounce the mind, renounce, give up a consciousness itself. This makes many people vary. Am I losing myself? And then they become afraid of Nibbana. But as you experience yourself, it is when you are most calm and there's no object whatsoever and you have no sensation of the body and even no sensation of the mind either, that you're most happy when meditating. So that points in this direction, that stilling is the way. If one stills all these processes, then one experiences happiness. If you engage in them, then you cling to them, then you experience panic, fear of losing. 6. Experiencing a happy pleasure, or also bliss, could be a good word, albeit in and out. Usually I will use the word, the code or the mnemotechnic rail, like that. Like when you are putting your head on the pillow, or like when you have eaten a nice meal and you're very relaxed, or while you have had sexual satisfaction, for example, or while taking a shower. This feeling one feels, this I will use as, because it's a mix of pleasure and happiness. Another code word could be to consider Nibbana, consider the qualities of Nibbana, which is inexpressible, but could be expressed in 3 words. Nibbana paranang sukkang, said the Buddha. Nibbana is the highest bliss. One could also say complete freedom, namely freedom from all suffering. One could also say absolute peace. But it is not 3 things, it is only 1 thing. It is not a place, it's a state. So now you can already start to can say, why does he want to do this in second tetrad? He wants to induce rapture, because this is one of the jhana factors. You remember this was enraptured joy was the 3rd factor. And then a pleasurable happiness. So now you calm the body, so you turn up the joy, you turn up the happiness, then you have 2 more factors under your belt, if you still have your focus and have excluded the 5 hindrances. So now we have 7 plus, so very close, coming, targeting in, concentrating and, experiencing also mental activity, I will breathe in and out. Then I will typically do like this. If they're seeing, even if you see black, you notice there's visual consciousness, but you are looking, trying to look out of your, under your eyelids, then I will see seeing. If they're thinking, conceptual thinking about the bills or the kids or whatever, the work or the sangha, I say thinking. If there's hearing anything, something inside the room here, I say hearing. If there's smelling, usually there's not, but there can be. If there's tasting, usually there is. Now we just eaten, there will still be some aftertaste. I say tasting. This only is a moment. If there's feeling in the body, I would say feeling. feeling in the pain in the knee or feeling your buttocks or whatever. They say feeling. If there's anything wanting or willing, you want to do something, then you say wanting. So whatever there is, this I would label, and then label as a mental activity. So whatever there is, and this goes quickly. So then you feel something, then you think something, then you try to see something, then you try to imagine something. So it quickly jumps around. This is just experiencing and labeling. Okay, then what to do? Last one is calming all mental activity. I will breathe in and out. How to do it? Yes, I traditionally do like this. There's only one object that you should not calm, and that is the breast touch in the nostrils. So there's one sensation that is this very subtle, cotton-like breast touch in the nostrils. This you should not calm. But you will experience, as soon as you intensify the focus on the breath touch in the nostrils, then the other sensations, the other mental activity will go down. I typically also say, if I see something or if I hear something, then I was like internally, conceptually shut the door. I don't know. If there's somebody who wants to come in and in some sound that wants to come in, I shut the door. We have something that called the one door theory in Buddhism, that all the six senses, all the five senses, seeing, hearing, smelling, tasting, and touching, they report to mind. And this you can only do through attention. So basically also now, while I'm talking to you, you can maybe feel, and you can still feel there's neural signals from your feet that they touch the floor. But because you have your senses on another focus, then you cannot feel it, though there's still a signal from your feet touching the floor. So this means that if you focus on one of the given one, then the other one is kind of like excluded. And the only one should keep is this tactile focus on the breast touch. Only one you should keep. Everything else, shut it out. Just close it down. Thinking, conceptual thinking, blah, 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 up and down the doorway, no. Feeling your buttocks, no. Wanting to go into the toilet or wanting to leave the meditation pillow, no. Thinking, no. No, don't open the door for anything. Don't open the door for anything. Only one thing. Stay there. Then the other sensations in successful cases become more and more faint until they do not disturb. In the beginning, one is raped by them because they just come tumbling in. Now they're also tumbling in now, but you're not aware of it. So it doesn't bother you. But as soon as you start experiencing them, then you do become aware of them, and then it looks like kind of like there's an elephant in the ballpark all the time, basically ruining the whole thing. So all the flowers are trampled upon. But if one keeps closing the door, then there will only stand this flower of your breast touch, and then that's where it starts to become really pleasant. It's not effortless, but it's pleasant. And that is conducive to the concentration. This is more or less the second tetrad, straight to the third tetrad. Number 9, experiencing the present mood, I will breathe in and out. So the text says that this is more or less a mind seeing mind. So if the mind is, if one looks at his own mind or at other's mind, one sees a contracted mind as a contracted mind, and a non-contracted mind as a non-contracted mind. What is a contracted mind? This is a mind dominated by lethargy and laziness. One sees a scattered mind as a scattered mind, and a non-scattered mind as a non-scattered mind. What is a scattered mind? This is one that is unmindful. It's jumping, sipping. Basically being not focused, the opposite of being focused. One sees an agitated mind as an agitated mind, and a non-agitated mind as a non-agitated mind. One sees a concentrated mind as a concentrated mind, and a non-concentrated mind as a non-concentrated mind. One sees a surpassable mind as a surpassable mind, and an unsurpassable mind as an unsurpassable mind. Surpassable mind will say, For example, the mind we've been in right now, we could do it better, we could establish deeper focus, so it can be surpassed. While if in jhana, whatever kind, or enlightened, then it cannot be surpassed. So this is basically the melody. One can also train by seeing other, by seeing the jealous mind as a jealous mind, and an unjealous mind as an unjealous mind. By seeing a satisfied mind as a satisfied mind, and an unsatisfied mind as an unsatisfied mind. One will first, to the extent one can identify the state, the mood, the mental state of one's own mind, one will be able to identify others' mind, just by looking at the signs. So it's a accentuation or precision of how a mind is, basically. What is the outer signs? What are the inner signs? So it's, one becomes better at probing one's own mind, and thereby also at probing others' mind. Number 10, gladdening, elating and satisfying the mind, I will breathe in and out. Again, he's going for the same thing. Gladdening the mind, elating the mind, satisfying the mind, I will breathe in and out. Concentrating, and I usually also say condensing and focusing the mind, I will breathe in and out. We remember that happiness was the cause of concentration, of samadhi to occur. So first gladdening the mind and then concentrating it is the right sequence. As soon as one has satisfied the mind by gladdening it, then it's easy to focus it and concentrate it. So I usually say it in the following order. When gladdening the mind, I use internal imagery of lifting the mind off of suppression, gladdening the mind, making it happy, making it glad. When concentrating, and then I usually will say, look like this, first, focusing the mind. This is one quality that making it more one-pointed. And then after one, I would say condensing the mind. Just like boiling a sauce, then you boil it down, boil it down, boil it down, then it becomes more and more thick, more and more dense. Same thing with the concentration. Make it more dense. And then concentrating the mind. So, focusing, condensing, concentrating. Concentrating will cover more or less both the condensing and the focusing, but they seems to be easier when one has focused it first and condensed it. Now one have kind of like done a lot of exercises where one have hold the mind very tight and controlled it by external force and by deliberate force from outside. The next one is releasing and liberating the mind, a bit in and out. And this should be like you have a bird in your fist, or like in your, like this one, then let it go. Releasing the mind. Just letting it, losing one's grip in one quick go of this tight grip one has had of the mind. Why so? Because whatever grip you put in the mind, it will be felt a little bit like a restriction or a prison or something that is like a binding of the mind, while the opposite is what you want, actually to release it. So gladdening, condensing, releasing the mind, like setting a bird free. But typically I will do, when having trained a period, then you typically say, if I start the 16, I also end the 16. But if I don't have any more time, then I will speed up the last 4 points or whatever. But the ideal is to go through all 16 in one sweep. But it's difficult not to do, to use less than an hour on one sweep. If you go too quickly, you not gain entry anyway. So there's no point in kind of like zipping it, except if one wants to remember all the points. There's somebody who has asked, the question, can you focus on the current meditation point and then the breast touch at the very same time? No, this one you cannot do. So you do body scanning and then the breast touch, then you are basically going back and forth. It is only if you are distracting from the knee, then go back to the breast touch. Always go back to the breast touch. But it's one thought away, so it's never far away. But as soon as you get lost into the jungle of distraction, then you can, in 2 minutes, become very far away, both from the knee or body scanning and the nose. So this, in this regard, stay with the breath touch.
Do you practice the method where you go from the nose to the crown?
No. Not body scanning. I will go through all the as many anatomical details I want, scanning up and scanning down, but not in particular. This is more like Hindu or chakra praxis, I think.
I'm talking about the Vipassana technique where you go.
Yeah, some people do that. I don't. It's not a part of the classical way. Is there any more questions? Yes.
Do you just cultivate the feeling without any kind of visual that is associated with it? Because sometimes I see, like, you know, I have to bring some kind of vision or experience that reminds me of that.
Yes, whatever you can. If pink balloons work for you, then pink balloons work for you. Just as long as there's joy. As long as there's joy. For, because that's the point, it's the joy and happiness that opens the way for the mind to be absorbed.
Right. So
otherwise it won't.
Yes.
Associated, yeah. Yeah. Whatever primer you can find. Whatever primer you can find.
This.
What is the relation of this practice with the acquisition or experience of insight?
Because we are taking any kind like piecemeal, we should not have cut it here. We should go get straightly into this point. But you can say, already here, when you see the scattered mind as non-scattered mind, the concentrated mind as concentrated mind, we are straying into insight. We have left the true calming, tranquility of the mind and tranquility of the body, we left behind. So now the third tetrad is kind of like in between. It is both calm and insight. And the fourth one we'll do now is exclusively insight. Why do we want to focus the mind, calm it down? Because in the case of absorption, but also in the case of any preliminary concentration up to that, it will see it directly. It does not kind of like skip over. So when ideally when we go now to insight, then it will accept whatever it sees. So whatever it sees. If it's fully absorbed, then it will have equanimity of seeing it. Otherwise, when you normally see something that you don't want to see, you skip it or disagree, huh? Or if you see something that you like to see, then you get stuck on it. But the seeing in the concentrated case, in the ideal case, is just seeing it from above, like you are very far up in a high-rise house, then these beings running around down there, and whatever they do, whatever they say, it is kind of like a little bit, I wouldn't say irrelevant, but you look at it in another way than having you been one of the beings there, them yourself. Then you'll be very much involved, emotionally involved, what the other beings are doing. So seeing it from above gives this equanimity. It's neither sadness nor is it gladness. It's neither pain nor pleasure. It's just neutral, indifferent, cool facts, observation. And that's insight. That's insight.
Well, what would we like to see in the step when we're freeing the mind? Are we looking for insight in
No, I will not say that you're looking for insight. This is still a trick that has to do with that one has gladdened the mind, concentrated mind, still one feels kind of like a little bit like the mind is in a restricted situation. It is not free. It is not set free. So one's joy and gladness there is restricted, and that's the purpose of setting it free. That's the purpose of setting it free. Setting it free can give this absorption. Then the insight follows. This is the last tetrad we're going to now, which is exclusively insight. It has nothing to do with calm. Any more? Otherwise, we'll go to the last one.
One more.
Okay. Yeah.
Start focusing on something else.
Yeah.
You talked about number 11, concentrating the mind.
Yes.
You just go back to the
Yes, yes. But I'll also try. Will I stay with the breath touch? But I'll also imagine the mind as being boiled down, as being compressed, as being condensed, as being focused on only one point. That is not necessarily, but it's kind of like an imaginary thing, while staying with the breath touch. Yeah? So. Yes, you can say exactly funnel is a good word. So compressing it, condensing it, making the focus more and more sharp, one-pointed. That's a trick. Okay. Let's take the fourth tetrad. Contemplating impermanence, I'll breathe in and out. Then I'll typically do the following sweep, because that's the most easy thing to pick it up. We have this four called the five aggregates. What are they? The five khandhas is also called. I call the five clusters of clinging. This is an all inclusive classification that most beings can pick it up under. What are they? They are form, feeling, perception, mental construction, and consciousness. Form will be the body. So this is internal form. That is external form. That is also external form. This can be past, present, and future. Internal form, past, present, and future, external form. All of it is form. Clinging to form is a problem. Clinging to the body, for example, induces the fear of death and fear of becoming sick. You had a question? Oh, okay. Feeling. Again, there's pleasant feeling, painful feeling, neutral feeling. There's past feeling, present feeling, and future feeling. There's external feeling, internal feeling. All that is cluster, all clinging to that, all like of that. For example, somebody loves you, or somebody have loved you in the past. It will be past external feeling. Your own feeling of pleasure now is present internal feeling. So whatever feeling there is, this comes under this cluster of clinging to feeling. Perception will be anything seen, heard, tasted, touched, thought of, imagined, any mental state and idea. Form, feeling, perception. Mental construction, sankhara, is a notably intention, all willing, wanting, hoping, planning. Basically everything is a sankhara, but these are the prime things. Anything that has all these intentional activities or formations, sometimes also translated, they are put together. So one perceives the object, then one wants to do something with it. This is a formation, this is a construction, mental construction. Consciousness itself, visual consciousness, auditory consciousness, olfactory consciousness, gustatory consciousness, tactile consciousness, mental consciousness. All this is the cluster of clinging to consciousness. Again, internal consciousness, not me, not mine, not what I am, external consciousness. Not he, not she, not what, not they, but just consciousness. All this one will contemplate under the heading of impermanence. All this is impermanent, obviously. Whatever hope there has been, planning there has been, feeling there has been, sensation there has been, consciousness there has been, will be and is now, all that is impermanent. So one stamp in the universality of this impermanence, that you cannot have any form, feeling, perception, mental construction or consciousness that is not impermanent. That is not impermanent. And this one keeps staying with, this is inside, getting a universal, because it's so much, it's so quickly, there's an idea and you can escape this impermanence, you can't keep this or that body. You can't keep this or that body of your lover or your friend or your mother, or you can't keep this or that bank account. You can't keep this or that job. You can't keep this or that social status, this or that habitation, this house, but just to name a few, this identity. You can't keep this or that personality. No, no, you cannot. Nobody can. Nobody ever could. Nobody ever will be able to keep anything whatsoever. And this is what pulling out the teeth, you can say, of this illusion of the whole idea of counting on these objects as source of happiness. This is inside. basically getting a handle on everything is impermanent, and therefore it is suffering, and therefore there's no self. It's not me, not mine. So contemplating impermanence, I'll breathe in and out. Again, I'll contemplate classically form, feeling, perception, mental construction, and consciousness, past, present, and future, internal and external. Then it's a full sweep. There's not a stone on left, there's another speck of dust out there, or in here, or ever have been, or ever will be, that is not impermanent. And one does not get intuitive certainty that it is so. And this is where kind of like one is clipping off the mind's small dirty tricks to jump into a hole and say, ah, this, there is still this thing. I can put my certainty or my future on this thing, then I can become happy. I can find my lasting happiness there. No, you cannot. If you fool yourself, you have to pay. So this is inside par excellence. Because it is impermanent, then one quickly realizes, ah, this is also suffering, this is also dukkha. It's a bad state, dukkha. Because it's a bad state, one becomes disillusioned. They also say fading away of what? Of lost desire for this object. Whether it's form, again I will use the five khandhas, form, feeling, perception, mental construction, and consciousness. What do I mean by, why do I think disillusion is a better rendering of viraga? Because that is exactly what is meant by it. That is to say that you give up the idea that there's happiness in the body, lasting happiness, or in samsara, or in others' body, or in your bank account, or in your social status, or in whatever object you can find in samsara. You give up the idea, and this is disillusion. One have lived in, and we live now, are not awakened yet from an illusion. So living or coming out of this dreamlike misinterpretation of samsara, misinterpretation of reality as permanent, as lasting, as something that you can keep and clutch onto. This is what awakening is all about. And this one do with this disillusion. And this basically, Buddha described it as, if one sees the lust, the desire, the attachment, the clinging to the object as a very colorful sense desire, color in clothes, then it fades away like if you hang clothes in the sun. So a very bright colored, red colored, for example, a piece of cloth will slowly, slowly, slowly lose its luster, lose its color, corresponding to one's attachment, one's clinging to the object. Slowly, slowly, slowly fades away. And it's something that one has to work at significantly, because we have been clutching onto these objects for as long as samsara has lasted, for billions of existences. Ants, devas, fish, anyone clutch onto their sense desire, to their junk, basically. Huh? Anyone, because that is a way, that is the only hole the putuyana, the ordinary being, has to happiness. It is these momentary blips of sense pleasure. Seeing something from modern art to porn to films, hearing something, music for example, smelling and tasting something during the sexual act or during eating, touching something, also notably in the hands and genitals during the sexual act, or just a pillow while sleeping and so forth. So it's all something that we clutch onto and say, since it has given all these points of pleasure and all these small blips of happiness, then it still makes sense to hang on here to samsara. And then one doesn't give it up. However, since it is impermanent, then it's suffering. How can one be freed of suffering while clinging to it? Huh? It is not possible. So as long as one clings to this object, these forms, these feelings, these perceptions, these mental constructions, and these six kinds of consciousness, then one clings to suffering. One will experience suffering. Why so? Because they fade away. They are impermanent. They are not lasting. And when these things undergo change, then one feels sorrow because now they are becoming otherwise. If you want it like this, then when it becomes like that, then it's felt as a loss. It's felt as a loss. And this inevitably induces sorrow. Now there's we're not youngsters in here anymore. So everybody has seen their own body decay. Huh? And this is, of course, when you look yourself in the mirror, it's obviously not a happiness. It is obviously suffering. Buddha said to his monks one day, you see this mountain? Yes, Venerable Sir. Just this, in this aeon, this kalpa, this universal cycle, you made a stack out of a lot of bones that is bigger than this mountain. What is it that you want? Do you want to make a mountain of bones more? And this is perspective on the long scale. Huh? To make you and I, we also make a mountain of bones, a Himalaya of bones. Imagine to make one more Himalaya of bones. Is that happiness? Obviously not. Obviously it's running in circles, completely blind, like a rat in a burning pyramid or in a burning cinema. So this now mind is ready. It can take the harsh, the bitter medicine. So it becomes disillusioned with it. When it becomes disillusioned, how it is experienced? It is experienced as freedom. It is experienced as a very cool, naked look at reality. That is insight. That is vipassana in itself. There's no illusion. There's no hanky-panky, no perfumed thing left, kind of like saying you can escape out of, which basically is an illusion and will make you suffer in the future. One ticket, one step further, contemplating ceasing, I will breathe in and out. We again, if we take the analysis, one can use several wrinkles as name and form. This is what's one angle to add it. If one doesn't use the five khandhas, the five clusters of clinging, then one use the 12 elements, that is the eye and the forms. But I think the five khandhas are best, they are most handleable. Contemplating ceasing of those, one breathe in and out. What is the cause of the body? Yeah, obviously it's food. So we take form first, it's the body. It's kapalinkara hara, it's food. But before food, there has been lust for having a body. That's why we get a body this time, because we had lost to have a body in the last life. Then there's karma, the karma to have a human body, or an animal body, or a divine body. And then there's ignorance, ignorance of the Four Noble Truths regarding bodies. Ignorance of that body, having a body always is suffering. So these are the causes of the body. So lust for having a body, karma corresponding to getting a body, and ignorance of that all bodies are suffering. Then add food, then you have a body. When you have a body, you have aging, sickness and death. Aging, sickness and death is suffering. So this means how to get it to cease. Yeah, then one should stop feeding it. Imagine when you sit feeding, I often do. What are you feeding? I'm feeding suffering. You're feeding, I'm feeding aging, sickness and death. Is that rational? No, obviously not. But then one contemplate the ceasing. If I can stop feeding, if I can stop having lust for the body, if I can stop karma corresponding to getting a body, that is karmic ego, karmic probabilities, if I can stop ignorance about having a body is suffering, then I can stop having a body. And I can stop making mountain of bones. This is obviously one first preliminary action one has to take before entering Nibbana. Nobody who enters Nibbana have a body. There's no bodies in Nibbana, no forms. Same thing with if we take it regarding feeling. What's the cause of feeling? It's contact. So considering feeling, one say, okay, then if I should eradicate all feeling, then I should stop having contact, sense contact. And the same also the other thing, I should stop having lust for feeling. Both lust for pleasant feeling, lust for neutral feeling, lust for painful feeling, which we also have, not only masochist. Then I should just karma corresponding to having feeling, and ignorance about feeling, that some feeling this usually will park, there's some feeling that is not suffering. For example, that pleasant feeling is not suffering, while still it is suffering because it's impermanent. Same goes with perception and mental construction. They are all caused by contact. So if one can cut contact, lust, karma and ignorance, then one can stop, cease, completely still, silence is probably a better word, silence, feeling, perception and mental construction. Mental construction. Here one should not be kind of like start to vacillate or waver, because nothing is lost there. It is still, one is still brooming out suffering from one's existence. Contemplating ceasing of consciousness, which I personally feel is difficult, that is to say, now I want to renounce, give up, relinquish visual consciousness, basically the ability to see something, to hear something, to say something, to touch something, and to have mental states, mental consciousness. I think I have difficulties because I identify, this is my last defense, this is what I believe is me, what I am. This is myself, my consciousness, as a collective thing. Not being fully, or can you say, adequately aware that consciousness arises and ceases, arises and ceases. So if I think I'm my consciousness, then I should entertain the point of view that this me, this I, this what I am, this arises and ceases, which is, of course, untenable. Huh? So there's no I in there, there's no me in there, I'm not owner. I do not have consciousness. I am not consciousness, nor do consciousness, nor is there any consciousness inside me, nor is there any me inside consciousness. If I can get insight about that, then I can also say, ah, consciousness is also suffering. Then I can also relinquish, if consciousness is suffering, I can relinquish my lust to be conscious. And ideally also the karma, that all the actions we do for becoming consciousness in the next life. This is basically contemplating ceasing, or cessation, or silencing, or stilling. Stilling is probably also an expression people can go forth with without inducing fear. Where does the fear come from? If one has fear of nibbana, it comes from because one identifies with form, with feeling, with perception, with mental construction and consciousness. One thinks, ah, this is me, this is what I am. Not seeing that it arises and ceases for every moment. So there's 20 wrong views regarding this issue. Either you think I am the form, feeling, perception, the mental construction and consciousness, or I own it, I have it, this I, this hypothetical I that doesn't exist, this have, is endowed with, is have ownership over, form, feeling, perception, mental construction, our consciousness. Or that this hypothetical I that doesn't exist is somewhere hidden inside it. It is inside consciousness, or inside mental construction, inside hopes, inside or inside feeling, inside all my emotions, all my memories. This is what I am. This is me. This is what I'm made out of. Or that the last point of view is that there's an ego, there's an I, there's a personality, and it's the same stable I one is desperately falling in love with and clutched to in deep panic. There is consciousness inside this I, or feeling, perception, mental construction, hopes, for example, inside this I. And neither is the case, actually. They're just arising and ceasing states. Is there any question to this one? This is a hard pill to swallow, huh? Here one has really started the brooming, one has started the relinquishment. Yes?
It might be outside scope. But
okay.
So if you are none of those things,
yes,
what are you?
I would say there's no you who are, but there is form, feeling, perception, mental construction, and consciousness. They are all momentary. As we saw yesterday, I tried to, for example, form. Form is a mental state. It lasts one plank moment, or one mental state, one Dhamma. It arises and ceases right where it is. So it's by no means the same body, nor the same house, the same stone, the same America, or the same planet Earth. And the same goes with feeling. Here we will induce some pseudo-permanence, or pseudo-constancy over, even though we see mental objects change and there is molecular vibration at the microscopic scale, we still perceive it No, it's a kind of like quasi-stationary thing. We still perceive it as the same book. And same also with the other things, with your own body, and with your feelings, you perceive it as the same, basically the same entity. But when you have dig deep enough in impermanence, then you will see that this Dhamma, this state that Buddhism deposits, it lasts only this one moment, then it's gone. So there is nothing, nothing whatsoever that lasts more than this Planck moment. It's a Planck moment, then it's 10 to the minus 34 seconds. Huh? So you cannot keep it, you cannot keep anything for a millisecond. I think it's particularly obvious with all the mental factors. Can you call back any in the forest? No. Can you call back the visual consciousness of just 2 seconds ago? No. Can you call back the feeling? Can you preserve the perception of anything? Can you preserve your thoughts? No. No, you cannot. So there's nothing in there that is the same. Since there's nothing in there that's the same, then there's nothing that is identical with itself from one moment to the next moment. Then there cannot be any identity in there. So it's a flux, it's a flux. And this, seeing this as a flux, as an impersonal flux of processes, basically, then one detaches from it. One detaches from it. Another answer to your question was an arahat called Nagasena that met a general from Alexander the Great, something in the first century BC, when Alexander the Great tried to invade India. And then he left a kingdom up in Magadha, probably somewhere in Pakistan, to this general. And he then met an arahat. Then he said, who or what is a person? And then Nagasena answers, Nasaso, Nasa Anyo. And it means neither the same nor another. Neither the same nor another. And that's really good to keep focus on. There is no person. There's never been any person. Yes, it's true that we say I and you and Mr. Trump, and we put a label on. In the conventional sense, is what we call conventional truth that is this person. But if we look into what it really is, the Paramatyasatya, the absolute truth of it, then it's just processes. Processes. And these processes are never ending. They cannot be arrested or frozen or kept. And because they cannot be kept, then it's inevitably causing sorrow to cling to them. It's kind of like a little bit to try to, this. You have this form, feeling, perception, mental construction or consciousness. Whether you perceive it as yourself or as somebody else, maybe somebody you love, then you try to carry it down the beach. It's like having water or sand in your hand. You lose it sooner or later. It's impossible not to lose it because it's inherently unstable. And that's the insight. One has to kind of like dig deep into these three universal characteristics we call Tilakana, three signs, that everything is impermanent, it is not lasting, it is inconstant, it is transient, it is ephemeral, it is something that comes and goes. When in the moment of perceiving it is already gone, the moment of perceiving it is already gone. Therefore, consequently, therefore, it is also suffering because it cannot be kept. And what one is looking for is lasting happiness, not just a blip of happiness. Huh? Because it is not lasting and suffering, then it is also inherently not me, not mine, not what I am. It cannot be a self. Why not? Yes, there are two arguments of it. The first one is that it's changing. As in the concept of self, if you take as a psychological entity, then there is inherently the idea that it's the same self, and that's also how we perceive it. Okay, we see there's a baby, there's a middle-aged man, and there's a man with a long beard. This is not the same physical form, but still, in this quasi-stationary thing, we impose it's the same personality or identity. And this is not the case, obviously, not the case. Neither is the molecules the same, nor is the mental constituents the same. There's some habits and some traits that is carrying over, but it's a very quasi-stationary thing. Let's take, for example, one thing I often use as an example. So Now we will say this is external form. Nobody will say this is me, this is mine, this is what I am. And then suddenly we don't. Eh? Now suddenly what was not me, not what I am, this is now indistinguishable from me, what I am, if you perceive your body to be yourself. And then when I go to the toilet, then some of this me, come back, you cannot leave me now. This obviously we don't do. So it's a very, very phony idea about what this self we have. Huh? And if you perceive this quasi-stationary thing as yourself, then you are up for suffering. Up for suffering because it's always loose, because it always becomes otherwise. And because it never was you or what you are made of or owned by you in the first place. In the first place. And the same goes for this feeling, this perception, this mental construction and consciousness. I hope this answers this question. Yeah. This is the Buddha say, if I remember the citation correct, one thing he say, to be free from sense desire, this is a level of bliss. Harmlessness is also a level of bliss. But to eradicate this abysmal self-deception, I am, asmi mana in Pali, this is the highest bliss. One gives up the idea. Long before one have given up the idea, all pride, all arrogance, including having fear of losing the body, becoming sick, this evaporates, this goes away. But it's counterintuitive. And it's, one can only learn it from a Buddha or from a disciple of the Buddha, that there is no self and there is no substance out there. So it's a subtle point. Is there more among these lines? Was this insight? Maybe not the insight you expected. Okay, contemplating relinquishment, I will be in and out. If ceasing, we can go through it. I typically do the following sweep. Hang on. Only the cessation of all form, all bodies, is final freedom from all imprisonment. As long as you have a body, you're in prison. As long as you are in this world, in samsara, you're in prison. Only cessation of all feeling is the final freedom from all physical pain. If there is feeling, there will also be pain. Only the cessation, the complete stilling, complete ceasing of all perception is the final, irreversible freedom from all noise, from all disturbance. Only the complete cessation, complete stilling of all mental construction, of all hoping, of all planning, of all intending, of all willing, of all wanting, is the final freedom from all stress. And finally, the nail in the coffin, only the cessation of all consciousness is the final freedom from all suffering. So there one can like unplug the whole thing. And there one should not feel any pain, or feel any fear, or feel that anything is lost, anything else than suffering is lost, because this is not the case. One question that is pertinent to this issue is Nibbana, the Buddha say, Nibbana Pananang Sukhang. Nibbana is the highest bliss. And then on his deathbed, he said to Venerable Ananda, his nephew and you can say caretaker in the last part of his life, if the recluses and priests, they come and ask you, the Buddha have said, your master have said that Nibbana is the highest bliss. But he also said that there's no feeling and no consciousness in Nibbana. This has ceased. Then you should answer the following. Whatever happiness there is, this blessed one has called happiness. So it points to the commentarial discussion is that consciousness in our normal thing, according to they have visual consciousness, auditory consciousness, gustatory consciousness, and so forth, they always have an object. But what now This the Buddha didn't say, but this is a commentary some centuries later say, but what now if there can be a consciousness that doesn't have an object, doesn't perceive anything, except happiness? Then you can sneak through, if you want. But otherwise, one should not be afraid of stealing these five clusters of clinging, because they are really only suffering. There's nothing else there. There's nothing else there. And that's inside, seeing that. Seeing that they are all impermanent. That's easy to see. It's easy to see they are permanent, that they are coming and going. No consciousness is the same. Obviously, you have now, huh? They are changing from one moment to the next moment. So seeing the impermanence is also easy to see the suffering. The last thing is a little bit difficult, to see that it's not a self, not a me, not a mind, not what I am, nor what I can be. That takes time. But that's, you can say, the final relinquishment, one gives it up. Should we try that? We have 20 minutes. Are there any questions? Okay. Don't be afraid of Nibbana. Don't be afraid of losing yourself. You never had a self in the first place.
You can drive me home after I give myself up.
Okay. There's nothing to take home.
You heard Bhikkhu Sammahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy, thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.